Don, do you mind turning off your camera for just a moment? Is that possible? Thank you. Good evening, everyone, and welcome. Our program will begin in just a moment. Hi, everybody, and welcome. My name is Colleen Stovall, and I'm the Director of Programs and Events for the Miami Center for Architecture and Design, and we'd like to welcome you to this event this evening. And as the slide was saying earlier, if you could do me a favor and keep yourselves muted and keep your videos off, it'll help us with bandwidth, and we'll have a smoother presentation. We will be having questions and answers if we have time towards the end of the program. And what you could do is please put them in the chat at the bottom of your Zoom screen and address your questions to everyone. And if we have time, we will get to them at the end of the program. And then if our panelists are willing, we will submit the questions to them and they can answer them and we can get them back to you. This program will be recorded, and right now I'd like to introduce the MCAD Board President and President of Sound Design Group, Jason Hagopian.
Thank you, Colleen. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, sounds good.
All right, just like to check. Thank you for that. Welcome, everybody, to this incredible program tonight. We had a record number of registrations, and we're seeing everybody filing in right now. As Colleen said, my name is Jason Hagopian, President of the Board for Miami Center for Architecture and Design. For those of you, maybe this is one of your first events with us, the Miami Center for Architecture and Design is the place for everyone interested in design and the built environment, with community meeting space, educational programs, to enhance public appreciation of architecture and design. And you may also not know that MCAD is the home for AIA Miami, as well as the Downtown Miami Welcome Center in partnership with the Miami Downtown Development Authority. So the Welcome Center is everything Miami, from cultural events, attractions, maps, history, and more. So we have a lot going on. MCAD has been busy despite everything that's been happening around us. Our upcoming events, right now there's an exhibit we have at our center downtown, Miami Creative, A Decade of Transformation. Please go to our website. It is that you can schedule a time to actually come and see the exhibit in person. It is incredible. It will be up for a little while longer. I'll give you the contact information in a couple of seconds. Monday night, April 19th at 6 p.m., we have a program in partnership with the Copper Bridge Foundation and the World Congress on Art Deco in Buenos Aires. We'll be showing a short film highlighting the trip to Buenos Aires. Incredible, it should be a great, great event. And then coming on May 20th is our Urban Warrior Awards. This is our biggest event. It will be honoring Mayor Daniela Levine Cava, plus three finalists in three categories: Young Urbanist, Visionary, and Lifetime Achievement. So this is going to be a hybrid event. You know, ideally, we would be doing this in person, but it is a hybrid event. And we were made available a very small number of in-person tickets. And those, we are happy to say, I think have been sold out. So please, for all information on these events, including the Urban Warrior tickets, please go to miamicad.org for tickets. And always make sure to follow us on Instagram at @Miami_CAD to always find out more. So with that, it gives me great pleasure to introduce the Executive Director of Dade Heritage Trust, Christine Rupp.
Thank you so much, Jason, and hi, everybody. What a wonderful turnout. For those of you who may not be familiar with Dade Heritage Trust, we are Miami's largest historic preservation organization. We were founded in 1972, and our mission is to preserve Miami-Dade County's architectural, environmental, and cultural heritage through education and advocacy. And obviously, with that broad mission statement, we do a lot of creative programming to explain historic preservation and engage people in the future of historic preservation in Miami. And one of the things that we appreciate the most are our partnerships. And this partnership with MCAD AIA is certainly so beneficial to Dade Heritage Trust, because the built environment and the people and businesses that inhabit those buildings certainly hits on two of our mission points, the architectural and cultural heritage of our community. So we really appreciate this partnership. Thank you so much. Dade Heritage Trust has been involved in the Miami Marine Stadium for several years. It was, I guess, back in 2009 that the National Trust for Historic Preservation also took an interest due to Dade Heritage Trust efforts. I can tell you that I know in 2008, DHT, Dade Heritage Trust, started an initiative to promote preservation of the stadium. In 2009, the National Trust named it to its 11 most endangered list. In 2011, as a spinoff from DHT, an organization was formed called the Friends of the Marine Stadium. And with their efforts in 2012, along with DHC, the National Trust for Historic Preservation actually named the Marine Stadium a national treasure. So that kicked off a series of events. At the time, I was not employed at DHC, but I was the executive director at the Coral Gables Museum, which at the time had a focus on the civic arts and architecture. And I was lucky enough to be contacted by one of the panelists tonight, by Don Wirth. Don came to me wondering if the Coral Gables Museum might be interested in showcasing the Marine Stadium via an exhibit. And I, of course, said yes. He then introduced me to Rosa Lowinger, who's another panelist. Rosa became the curator for a beautiful exhibit we did called Concrete Paradise. It kicked off in 2013, and the exhibit featured obviously the history and architecture of the stadium, artifacts, and then we had some wonderful Marine Stadium inspired works of art. But I think from my perspective, a couple of the most impressive things that happened through that exhibit were the production of a video, which you're going to see this evening, that really tells the story of the stadium itself. I can tell you that I can't watch it without getting emotional, because it's so beautiful. That video was produced by Little Gables Group, and Rosa was obviously a very important person as far as interviewing and adding content to that video. So we engaged so many people with that exhibit, including the National Trust, who was the premier sponsor of the exhibit, along with American Express. So we actually even had Jimmy Buffett and Gloria Estefan at the Coral Gables Museum, and they presented a discussion and a private concert. It was fabulous. So I can tell you that there's been several times through my history of working on the Marine Stadium that we almost thought, okay, this is it. This is the time. It's turned the corner. And we still need advocates and we need your assistance in ensuring that that the Marine Stadium is preserved and becomes the premier venue in the whole state, if not the whole country. So thank you so much. It's a pleasure to be here.
Architecture is a piece of art that you create to be enjoyed for many, many years. One that can be alive, enjoyed, fully interacting with their community, talking to, listening to the community, and engaging with the community, and being preeminent with that community for life. The city had conducted a study because they were realizing that Miami had unique genes in the blood of Miami, and that obviously had to do with water, and it had to do with everything that water meant, and that if Miami had to offer that to the world, they had to do something in the water that was special, and out of that came the idea of doing a marine stadium on a piece of marshland that was between Miami and Key Biscayne. As an architect, we had to create a home for a marine event around boat races, etc., etc. I always felt that there were many more things that should happen there. The opportunity of that site demanded that you could think way out into the future and into the opportunities that were there. It had to be a piece of art where the land and the water kiss each other. We had to celebrate that. I conceptualized it as this smooth, double curved, curving in two directions, in this direction and in this direction at the same time, that was going to take all this strength and they could be very, very thin.
Round, round, get around, I get around, yeah, get around, round, round, I get around, I get around. I gotta find a new place where the kids are hip. My buddies and me, you're getting real well known. Yeah, the bad guys know us and they leave us alone. I get around.
World's most beautiful speed sport. Action, beauty, speed, excitement. All around family entertainment. It's the greatest. A day crammed full of action.
The people of Miami, from the beginning, they enjoyed the building. They responded to the building. They say, we like it. They adopted the building. Along with that, they adapted the building for things that nobody had thought of, whether it would be classical concerts or religious services, all those things that really make a city alive.
Both Colson and Ms. Bryant say, regardless of their critics, they will continue to live by their religious beliefs. Ike Siemens, Channel 4 News.
Thank you. king. Watch him start bait. All of those turkeys covered with oil. I've seen them. Strumming my six string on my front porch swing. Smell those shrimp, they're beginning to fall. Bubble, 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 bubble. Wasted away again in Margaritaville. Here we are. Searching for my lost shaker sock.
As you can hear from the weather reports, it gets to be much more serious now, nearly as the moments go on.
Bob, did you ever think it would be this bad?
No, I did not. I don't think any of us comprehended this. I've looked at hurricane damage ever since I've been involved in the game, and certainly back in 1969, the Camille incident. Certainly areas of Camille is as bad as this, but as widespread as this, no, there's nothing to compare to this.
Is very important quality of good design. The community can redesign it mentally, not redesign the shape of the building, but redesign certainly the use of the building.
We gon' make it, that's some everything. Jewish girls get half naked early spring. I want to take a moment to talk to you about the Miami Marine Stadium. The Matheson family gave to the state, for public use, lands around Key Biscayne and Virginia Key. To quote the actual deed, this deed of conveyance is made upon the express condition that the land hereby conveyed shall be perpetually used and maintained for the operation of a Marine Stadium and allied purposes only. And in the event the use of said land for such purposes shall be abandoned, then and in such event, the title of said land shall revert to the grantor herein. Those grantors, the Mathesons, had a very specific purpose in mind for their generous gift, which is the reason that the Miami Marine Stadium was built in the first place. And when in 2008 a plan was unveiled to demolish the stadium, it unleashed a wave of distress and a call to action among people who not only love our city, but understand the importance of saving this gem for generations to come.
Hi, this is Jimmy Buffett here for the Miami Marine Stadium. Many of you may remember a few years ago when the Coral Reefers and I played one of, I think, the greatest shows we ever played in South Florida at the stadium. And I think the stadium deserves a future as well. We had a great time at the Marine Stadium. Let's do it again.
What a privilege I had to do it. What a privilege I'm having of looking at it again. I'm not interested in mummifying the stadium whatsoever. I think we preserve the stadium not to keep it exactly the way it is. We kept the stadium to save it, to go to the next phase of its life. The stadium should be about fun. It has to happen, because Miami deserves it. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. I hope you can hear me. I'm on a new, you finished sharing the screen, Colleen?
Yeah, we're ready to go and we can hear you.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. So that video really brought me back and probably did the same for many of you. I'd like to now bring, we're going to have a PowerPoint presentation with our two speakers. Then after that, we're going to go to a panel with Q&A. Hi, oh, I didn't introduce myself, did I? I'm Cheryl Jacobs, Executive Vice President of AIA Miami and the Miami Center for Architecture and Design. And let me reiterate what Chris said. This is a great partnership between Dade Heritage Trust and MCAD. And we love doing it, and we will continue doing whatever kind of programming that we need to do to work towards things like preserving and restoring the Marine Stadium and other structures. So let me bring now Rich Heisenbottle. Rich, if you want to show yourself.
Good evening. Good evening.
Richard is a founding principal and president of R.J. Heisenbottle Associates in the Gables, and with over four decades of expertise in all aspects of architecture and interior design, he's got a real specialty in historic preservation. And his work is well known around Florida for the restoration of some of our greatest projects. I'm proud to say, as an AIA executive director, Richard was elevated as a fellow back in 2005. And he currently sits on the University of Miami School of Architecture, MRED, Masters in Real Estate Development Board. He was past president of AIA Miami and Dade Heritage Trust as well. So then our next person, Rosa, I know you're there from California, calling in from California. Hello there.
Hello.
Welcome. Rosa is CEO and chief conservator of Rosa Lowinger and Associates, and she has over 30 years experience as a conservator of sculpture, contemporary art, and historic buildings. She holds an MA in art history and conservation from NYU's Institute of Fine Arts and is a fellow of the American Institute for Conservation and the American Academy in Rome and the International Center for Conservation in Rome. Her long and varied career has included fellowships at the UPenn Archaeological Museum, the LA County Museum of Art, and as field conservator positions for the joint UPenn-Tel Aviv University expedition to the coastal plain of Israel. And for both of those, our panelists today, I could probably go on for the complete hour reading their accolades, but I'm going to be quiet now and turn it over to Rich and Rosa.
Well, thank you very much, Cheryl. Thank you very much to MCAD for having us. Rosa and I are going to do a bit of a duet tonight as we go through this PowerPoint presentation, because we've done similar PowerPoint presentations in the past relative to the stadium. And I think we should probably explain a little bit, Rosa, that our various roles in the stadium. Let me start by sharing the screen here first. For those of you that may not know, okay, come on. There we go. My firm, R.J. Heisenbottle Architects, is the preservation architects for the restoration of the Miami Marine Stadium. And I must say that I have the great pleasure of not just being the restoration architect for such a spectacular historic project, but more importantly to me personally. for the ability to work side by side on this restoration with the man who created the building, a man who was my mentor growing up as a young architect, working for his firm as vice president, getting to do wonderful products with him and having him, frankly, teach me virtually everything I know about being a great architect and a good architect. And so I'm very proud to say that I not only do I get to restore this wonderful building and orchestrate a team of, I think we have 12 different consultants, but I get to do it with a man who was my best friend and still is, Hilario Candela. And one of the other wonderful people that I get to do it with is Rosa Lowinger. And Rosa is a conservator. And I'm not so sure that all of you know what that means, but through the course of this, she's gonna tell you. But a conservator is a restoration architect's best friend because they know how to do all those very, very difficult things with your building to make sure that as we go forward with these restoration projects, we actually maintain the integrity of the historic integrity that is inherent in all of them. So we're going to take you on a walk through both the construction of the original building and some of the events that like that wonderful Jimmy Buffett concert that I must say I was at. And if you had any idea how much fun the world had at that concert, you'd all be doing it again tomorrow. And then we're going to take you to the way the stadium is today, and you're going to see some things that are not nearly as pretty. And then we're going to explain to you where the product is going and where it is in its process today. I think there's a couple things we should tell you first. This is a little foreword that Hilario actually wrote for us. The city of Miami recognized the importance of its unique historic architectural heritage and embarked on the restoration of the 1963 Ralph M. Monroe Marine Stadium. Before I go stray from that paragraph, and you should know that is the 26-year-old Hilario Candela standing on the right-hand side here in the construction photo as a young man at the time that he was fortunate enough to get the opportunity to design this building. But I want to back up just a little bit and ask if everyone in the room knows who Ralph Monroe is. Stadium is named after a very, very famous man in the history of the city of Miami, Commodore Ralph Monroe. And I know I can't have you all talk back to me right now, which I would have loved to have done in person. But you should know that Commodore Ralph Middleton Monroe was a pioneer marine enthusiast and founding commodore of the Biscayne Bay Yacht Club and builder of the Barnacle, another state historic site. You should all know the Barnacle down in Coconut Grove on the water's edge. And going forward here with a little bit of plug for us, Hilario went on to write, to navigate this course of this new voyage for the stadium, the city has selected a qualified professional team that faces the challenge of finding a path that will ensure that this symbol of an era will not only be preserved, but also become an inspiration for future generations to enjoy its spirit and its innovation for years to come. And that is, ladies and gentlemen, our goal in restoring the stadium. And just to give you an idea of just how much concrete is here, I think everyone certainly should also know, Rosa, that this is a brutalist style building. Everyone, we're not living through the brutalist age today, but back in the 1950s and 60s and 70s, brutalism was a very, and even a little bit further, I suppose, was a major architectural movement. And as such, as a style, this building is an amazing example of concrete brutalism, of raw concrete. Rosa, chime in here, please.
Sure. No, no. You're definitely covering all the bases. When we get to fixing that brutalist concrete, then I can give a few thoughts on the matter.
And one of the things that one sees right away as we look at these photographs is the amazing cantilever that we have here. This is thin-shelled concrete. It is floating above the water. You can see it. You know, Hilario used the words in the video. Where the land and the sea came together and the stadium literally kisses the water. Well, it does kiss the water, and it overhangs the water in this massive cantilever that makes the work of architecture just so much more stunning with this folded plate roof.
And here I will chime in, Rich. One of the things about Hilario's background, this building is kind of a culmination of a lot of his studies and his training and his internships in Cuba with the great Max Borges, and who built the Tropicana nightclub, and a number of other Cuban architects. And one of the things to take into account is that was a period in the 1950s when Cuban architects were doing a lot of exploration on ways to make their roof lines more interesting. And they worked a lot with concrete, and Hilario comes directly out of that tradition. So this idea of the cantilevered roof is really very powerful for him. And also, In a number of the interviews that I've done with him, he talks a lot about a game-changing moment for him when he first arrived from Cuba, going to see the newly opened Dulles Airport in outside of Washington, D.C., and that the use of concrete in that extraordinary building really was, for him, a moment where he realized, I'm going to have a lifelong love affair with concrete.
And he certainly did, didn't he? We'll talk more about him and some of those other brutalist buildings of his as we go forward here. There we go. This is a perfect example of this photograph really shows that amazing cantilever, perhaps better than any other. This is the stadium when it was completed, when it was in living color, and from his own archives, when it was bright and shiny and new. And the photos being taken from what we call the stage barge, which floated in and floated out and gave a platform, a stage for the various kind of events that occurred at the stadium. But one, go ahead, Rosa, I can see.
I was just gonna say, I don't really think I know of any other building quite like this. There are other stadiums that bear a resemblance in other places, but to have it cantilevered over the water like that, and to have water be this marriage of concrete and water is really what makes it concrete paradise. And it's very unique to Miami. It wouldn't make sense anywhere else, wouldn't you say, Rich?
I don't think it would make sense anywhere else at all. It is one of those buildings that is truly unique to Miami. There are buildings similar to it. There are buildings similar to it in Cuba. None that express themselves so very carefully and sensitively by coming up and literally kissing the water like this. What we're witnessing here is something that probably most of you have never had the opportunity to see before. That's a hydroplane regatta, a hydroplane race out on Biscayne Bay that we're watching right here, along with 7,000 other people in these stands, being televised probably on NBC, literally all over our black and white television sets of the period. It was an amazing sport in its heyday, and it still exists, just not quite to the extent that it has taken over Saturday afternoon television. But you can just imagine the energy that existed at these regattas. All of the folks driving in from all over the country, racing different kinds of boats. This is what's called the Jersey skiff. I don't know if anyone ever heard of one of those, but they were often built out of wood, and they had Chevrolet 283 engines in them. They were amazing. And then, of course, there was always the hydroplanes at different classes of hydroplanes, and the most famous of which was Miss Budweiser. I don't think we have Miss Budweiser here, but she might be in here somewhere. And today there's still another a really great hydroplane. If you ever get a chance to see it, really unleash itself. The Geico.
And one of the other things I wanted to say is if anyone in the audience has ever been out to the building, one of the things that's really remarkable about it is on the hottest day of the year, it's cool in the building. If you're sitting in the shade, there's a great breeze. It's oriented in a way that even for Miami in the heat of summer, it feels good to be out there.
It is. It's really quite surprising that you're shaded because the orientation of the building is correct. And the sun is to your back, and that large cantilever does a wonderful job of providing shade, and yet the breeze blows right through the building as well. So really cool. But it wasn't, while it was purpose built, and the entire basin that you're looking at, and you'll see more of in a minute, was purpose built. This was all literally dug out of the bay, out of a marsh. And the land that it's built on was filled. We dug over here and we placed the soil there and we created this piece of property, something that certainly the Durham folks would never let us do nowadays. We have environmental bedlam. But as Hilario mentioned in his piece earlier, the stadium took on literally a life of its own. Yes, it was purpose-built to race boats, and then the community took over, and then the community found new uses, like the use that you're seeing here, this being a classical music concert, and another classical music concert, and the kind of events that occurred at the stadium are what have made it famous. It became not just an entertainment venue for the sport of boat racing, but an entertainment venue for all sorts of different things. An entertainment venue for boxing. Muhammad Ali was on that stage giving a boxing demonstration. But perhaps the most famous, of course, was the Jimmy Buffett concert. And I have to tell you, I was sitting in the stands right about there, dancing in the aisles with my wife, Donna, I must say, Rosa. And there was no better place to be on earth, because if you don't think these folks are having fun, you've never had fun before. There's Jimmy on the left, and Jimmy ending the concert by jumping off the stage, into the water, the best fun you could ever have. When we ran out of room in the stands, boats would pull up with just overcrowded boats would pull up and just sit there and watch, sometimes for free, although there was a guy down the other side supposed to be taking your money. When you didn't have room on the boat, you used the raft. And when you didn't have a raft, you used the inner tube. But whatever you were floating in or swimming in and around, you were having an amazing time in this really, truly unique venue. And at this time, I think Jimmy's 1975 here, but we have the Queen concert. At this day and age, we were doing it for $3. Can you imagine that? that much fun for $3? My gosh.
There's a pretty long list, I think, that Don Worth compiled of all the people that...
I'm going to just read you some of them, and you can see the diversity in the group as well. They range from Arthur Fiedler and the Boston Pops, Mitch Miller. Anybody alive here? Don does. He remembers Mitch Miller. Mitch Miller, Sammy Davis Jr., El Puma. I have a list that is actually a mile long. The stadium was actually even used for an Elvis Presley movie. Anybody remember Elvis Presley? I'm not so sure we have, as some of us age here, whether or not the younger generation even remembers how exciting that might have been to see an Elvis Presley movie or to have one filmed right here. But it literally took on all sorts of uses. Yeah. I was going to say, including political uses. Richard Nixon stood on that stage and addressed the community. And I think he shook hands with Sammy Davis Jr. there, which was actually a big deal for this Republican presidential candidate to be shaking hands with Sammy Davis Jr. And on the opposite end of the spectrum, we have the flotilla of the Virgin of Charity, Easter sunrise services, multi-denominational Easter sunrise services. So the stadium was literally, as Hilario said, adopted by the entire community with a great deal of enthusiasm. And it was used literally all the time until that fateful day in 1992 that we all know hit the community, Hurricane Andrew. And Hurricane Andrew closed it and left it in the kind of condition that you see it in today. Unfortunately, there was the building could easily have been repaired at the time. The damage was not nearly as severe as some of the damage that we all know occurred in areas south of us in the community. And of course, it was built all out of concrete, so it was going to stand up very, very well.
And the roof roof's rebar is galvanized, which is why it holds up so well.
And we can start mentioning certain things like that here because one of the structural engineering team that designed this deserves an equal amount of credit to my good friend Hilario. Had it not been for the structural engineering team having the good sense to build a roof like this first, this is pre-computer design. This is not you feed the building into the computer and of course the computer tells you exactly what steel you're going to need and what strength of concrete you're going to need. This is do it on the back of a yellow piece of paper and work out your calculations the hard way, the old fashioned way with a slide rule. And one of the fortunate things they did, as Rosa just said, was to build the upper portions of the stadium, the roof in particular, out of galvanized rebar, which has withstood the tendency of rebar, of course, to rust, and been a great savior to the condition of the roof. When we examined the roof as part of our assessment of the building very early on, that was one of the things that we remarked that was in excellent condition. Now, the lower section of the building is not in such excellent condition. The portion of the building that actually sits over top of the water was unfortunately not done in galvanized rebar and has an awful lot of repair work that we will be doing to it as part of the restoration process. So if you walk the building today, this is about the way it would look to you. There are concrete cracks here and there and under the building more than quite a few. But more than anything else, the artists are the ones that helped save the building. They took it over and they painted graffiti virtually everywhere. It became their canvas.
And we found about in our examination of the graffiti layers, we found close to 200 layers in certain places. And you know, the other thing is that the community, I don't know if you're here ready for this yet, but the community of artists has a great deal of respect for Hilario Candela, and in a couple of meetings that we've had with the street art community, there's been a lot of admiration expressed and also a sense that, look, if the city takes care of the building, the community will lay their hands off of it. They won't continue to tag it. But as many street artists have told us, is if the building's going to be just allowed to languish and be neglected and allowed to be destroyed, then it's fair game.
Well, I think one of the things we can discuss right now as we continue to walk forward in the process that we went through to get to where we are right now, which is a permitted or almost permitted set of construction documents, restoration documents. One of those processes was Rose's team of conservators testing how to safely take these, how many layers, Rosa?
200 in some places.
200 layers of paint off of the building without damaging.
Right, exactly. Sorry, Rich, I didn't mean to interrupt.
That's okay, without damaging the concrete. Please go ahead and tell them a little bit about that process, please.
So the key thing, and Rich has brought up the brutalist nature of the building a couple of times, which is important because the thing about this building is it's not intended to be painted. Hilarios very specifically wanted a low maintenance building. So that his brutalist building, the raw concrete, was a response to that. He had a lot of civic responsibility in his mind when he designed this. But this is a poured in place concrete building, and the form work that is used to do the pouring is part of the character of the building. And so if one went in there and sandblasted all these layers of graffiti off, you would destroy the appearance of the building. You would open it up to pockmarking and a really rather unattractive look. So the struggle has been figuring out a method for removing hundreds of layers of graffiti, and also graffiti that is embedded deep into the surface of that concrete structure without damaging the building. And our team first worked under a grant from the Getty Foundation. Getty Foundation in Los Angeles gave a series of grants to important worldwide buildings, and Marine Stadium was selected along with the Sydney Opera House and the Salk Institute to be one of the major buildings in the United States of the modern period. And the protocols for graffiti removal, cleaning, because there's also fungal growth and all kinds of other dirt embedded in the structure, and dealing with the repairs, because repairs on a building that is not going to be painted have to match. And that's a pretty tricky process. So that's been our firm's work to assist Rich's team in developing the brass tacks protocols for those repair and cleaning methods.
And along the way, of course, we'll have to replace all of that seating that you see there, not because of the paint that's on it, but because of the poor condition that it is all in. But one of the things I want you to just come away with understanding is that the city recognized the importance of this building. And in 2008, it was listed on the local Register of Historic Places. Thereafter, it was ultimately listed on the National Register of Historic Places. And what you see within the red dashed lines really represents the scope of that historic designation. So it's not only the stadium itself standing there as a piece, it's what surrounded the stadium, it's the land in front of the stadium as it comes up to the causeway, and it is the entire boat basin that is part of that historic designation. And part of that historic designation, one of the things that it does, it protects the stadium against demolition. Right. Being on the National Register is a wonderful honor, but it does not protect you from demolition, does not protect a building or historic site from demolition and removal. But being on our local register does that, and that's why this is even more important that it was designated in 2008. Right. And later on, if there's an interest, we can talk about why it meets the criteria for historic designation. But I thought it would be good to go through the process, not just the technical process that the team went through, this 12 firm team went through to come up with what the design would be and how it would be restored and what systems the building would have, those architectural engineering and theatrical things, but the community process that led to the future uses of the building. Part of our responsibility was also to program the building. What is the building going to be used for? Who's going to use it? We know that we'll have a contingent of A-listers, starting with Jimmy and Gloria, to kick off the stadium. And because of its uniqueness, I am sure that we'll have a continuous list of A-list talent that will want to use the stadium to showcase their talent and perform. But there are other uses that the stadium could have that have an even deeper and more important, perhaps, effect on the public as a whole. And we came up with, first we decided that we were going to have a charrette process to discuss publicly and to get public input for these uses. And we identified, as part of that charrette, we identified that marine and boating related uses were key to the success of the stadium going forward. Sports and fitness made great sense for the stadium going forward. Educational uses and nature made great sense for uses of the stadium. Community events and obviously entertainment as well. But community events, as opposed to just entertainment, all sorts of community events. And so there's Hilario right there. We ended up having our charrette over at the garage at Vizcaya, and had roughly 100 people attend in 2017, and each one of them got to draw, got to discuss, got to write down, got to brainstorm their ideas, and then share them with one another. And then the entire team collected that information, wrote it down, turned it into a program that made what we're doing with the stadium truly a community-based effort, not just a Rich effort or a Hilario effort or a Rosa effort, but truly a community-based effort. And I could show you dozens of photographs of this and all of the work that team did. But suffice it to say that it resulted in a whole series of very exciting uses, so that the stadium would not just be used for two or three special A-lister events on Saturday evenings, but that it would be used virtually, it could be used virtually every day of the year by the community in so many different ways. You know, rowing competitions, yes, the powerboat races, sailing regattas, dragon boat races, jet skis, water skiing competitions, wakeboarding. That's just some of the boating uses, but swimming competitions, triathlons, Ironman competitions, paddleboarding competitions, kayaking, trail jogging. There's a wonderful trail that goes all the way around the other side of the stadium. Makes a great place to go out and get some exercise. Exhibition games, the Red Bull Air races, watch out, drone races, community public meetings, again, all of those religious events that occurred in the past, those political events that occurred in the past, festivals, fairs, weddings, graduations, 4th of July, can't think of a better place, can you? You know, New Year's Eve's
coming. It's already, before it was locked down by the city to protect it, it had become the new venue for quinceañera photos.
It was a great venue. It was not only a great venue for quinceañera photos, but it was a great venue for RJ Heisenbottle Architects firm photos. that we had an awful lot of fun with. So again, we'll have concerts and movies and Art Basel events and music festivals and art festivals and beer festivals, actually, beauty pageants, TV shows, as in the past, Bellagio water shows, just imagine on a sleepy, warm, hot and muggy summer night, being able to go to the Marine Stadium watch an old movie from the stands of the Marine Stadium, and maybe those who wouldn't have the 6,000 seats that I've put back into the stadium full, but they will have 600 seats of folks from the community there enjoying it as well. So all of that was part of this process of design that we went through, so that the community would use the facility 365 days of the year. And in going forward, this is the overall site plan of the historic section of the stadium that reinterprets the original plaza in front of the stadium and turns it into a plaza and a venue in and of itself that could have events occur outside on the plaza. And this is how we expect that plaza to look when we've finished restoring the building, when we've restored that concrete and restored the graffiti, removed the graffiti, and added the wonderful architectural lighting that our team has worked so hard on. This is a good rendition of what I believe will be opening. Whoops, I went the wrong way. Opening night. Our pedestrian entry from the east, walking down amongst the trees in this particular case. Hilario got to design a new building as part of this, the new ticket building, which is itself a very special brutalist style building that I think you're going to love when we get that built. You'll be able to have Uber and Lyft drop you off, drop your car off, and valet park your car. Instead of leaving the graffiti on the building, as you know, as Rosa was telling you, we expect to remove it and to repair the building to its original finish and original colors. But we do have jumbo digital size digital screens, much like the one that is on the outside of the Heat Arena. Those are in areas where we're going to hang them on the outside of the building. They're actually not visible when they're not on, but very visible when they are on. So we can have events occurring in simulcast when they're out on the stage barge and there are 6,000 people screaming in the stands and there's no more room. We have another room for on the other side as part of a simulcast, much like they do on Miami Beach right now, with the simulcast of other theatrical events. And at the same time, we'll be able to put advertisements on those and also of all the photographs that have been taken of some of this wonderful artwork that the street artists have done, we can show those digitally on these large screens and still get to enjoy them without damaging the building. So this is the way most of you are probably architects here, I'm ready to bet. So you gotta see a floor plan, right? Well, this is the what we call the promenade level floor plan with the original stadium, but with also the new, what we call the stage barge, not a pretty name for it, but it is literally a stage house with all the theatrical capabilities of an Adrian Arsch center sitting out on the water. It floats in, it floats out, it moves around. We kid it around, take it to the Bahamas once if you like. But that is the stage with all the bells and whistles that an A-lister would need to properly perform. And we've also gone back and we've added concession areas into the building so that we'll have the usual standard concessions. You'll be able to get your beer for a Jimmy Buffett concert. Mm-hmm. But we also have some upscale concession areas that we have added that you're gonna see in a minute. There's a promenade, a mezzanine level plan that you're seeing here that provides handicapped accessibility throughout the stadium. At every ticket price, we have handicapped accessibility in this historic building. Really tough challenge, but one that we have met. And then the entire grandstand seating plan with different ticket prices and different levels and from box seating to general public seating. And ultimately with over 6,000 seats. But we also want to use some of the space outside. Think of how nice it would be to be able to sit out on the water's edge there and eat outdoors, have a breakfast outdoors, have a lunch outdoors. Under those umbrellas over there, overlooking the water, overlooking downtown Miami, or go to the stadium on any given night, and go to the concession area and the bar that we've created underneath the stadium, and literally have a great venue for not for just for food and drinks on the water as well. And of course, we will undoubtedly have another day and more than a few, I hope, where we'll be able to be in those stands once again. This is the stage barge you see on the right-hand side. Of course, this venue has the great fortune of being able to overlook downtown Miami's skyline, and I don't think there's really a better skyline anywhere. And you'll be able to see that with the price of admission. Will the boats be able to collect around the stage barge and view the stadium and view the events just like they did during the Jimmy Buffett concert? Well, maybe not in quite as unsafe a manner as we used to do it in the old days. But yes, we expect that folks will come and visit the stadium by boat and be able to enjoy a concert and event like the one you're seeing in one of my renderings here, as part of that from their boat. Now, if you're really lucky and your name is Rosa Lowinger,
what do I get to do?
You may get to go backstage where this rendering was taken.
Wow!
And look back at the restored stadium. And appreciate all of the wonder that it will bring. So hopefully we'll all get to do that, and Don will get to join us here.
That's great, Rich. I actually would love to bring Don on now.
Perfect.
So that we can continue our panel. The drawings are gorgeous. It's as wonderful as the building was before. Now it's going to be spectacular. So I'm sure we're all really excited to see it happen. Excuse me. And so if you could stop sharing your screen for now, and we can bring some back if we, if the need comes up when you're answering some of the questions. And let me bring in Don Worth. Don is a longtime preservationist who lives with his wife Nina in Miami Beach. And he, in 2008, he was one of the co-founders of Friends of Miami Marine Stadium, the original group that advocated for restoration of the project of the building. He presently remains involved in all aspects of the stadium restoration efforts and has co-founded the current advocacy group Restore Marine Stadium. And the website for that is restoremarinestadium.org. So Don, if you, I think you're there and
sure.
And you're unmuted.
Yep.
And so why don't we talk a little bit about the feasibility of moving forward with this project?
Sure. I think, Cheryl, the economic feasibility issue is really the number one threshold issue right now. When people have objections to the stadium, they usually bring that up. Some individuals have suggested that the Marine Stadium is a white elephant. And it's true, the Marine Stadium was not financially successful during its 28-year run. This is a legitimate concern, and I'd like to provide some facts to suggest how this thing might work. The City of Miami operated the Marine Stadium for 28 years, and I don't believe that governments or municipalities can run businesses, whether that's a restaurant, a hotel, a Marine Stadium. Is a precedent. In fact, the City of Miami also operated two other venues, Bayfront Park Amphitheater and the Knight Center. Miami lost money on both of those. They then went to an outside professional manager, and now the City of Miami makes money. It's not just a City of Miami issue, because Miami Beach ran the Jackie Gleason Performing Arts Center for years and lost money, They turn that over to an outside professional manager, and they're making money. So you look at the Marine Stadium, it is a very, very complex building. There are very few organizations that can run it. And you wonder, is anybody interested in running this? Because sometimes cities issue requests for proposals and nobody responds. I can tell you the answer is yes, because the city issued both a request for letters of interest and they actually did an RFP several years ago that they had to void for technical reasons. And several very fine firms, experienced, successful, capable of running the Marine Stadium, responded with a great deal of enthusiasm. So that's certainly a positive. I guess the next question is, well, what kinds of events are going to make money and who's going to finance them? And Rich, I love all of the community activities of the stadium. I believe it has a fabulous opportunity to be part of a great public park, but the city needs to generate revenue from this. It needs to be revenue positive. And I've spent really 13 years talking with promoters, event organizations, and executives. This, for me, has been sort of my key focus. I leave the architecture to the architects. I've brought in many, many people, including really some of the best entertainment executives with national and international reputations. And when I brought them into the stadium, I have to tell you, their jaws drop. They are absolutely stunned. I think of one guy, Kevin Wall. You can look him up in Wikipedia. Kevin has produced many large-scale events, including Live Earth, which was the largest set of simultaneous concerts that ever happened in the world. He was the one who uplit Eiffel Tower green. On the boat ride back, he turned to me and said, I don't understand it. Why isn't this done? When is this going to be done? What's taken so long? And I've met a number of other people on that level, all saying the same thing. So I can understand how somebody looks at me. I'm an advocate. What do I know? Of course I'm going to hype it. But my own confidence comes from dealing with people like Kevin, and I've had extensive relationships with a number of these people. They all say the same thing to give me great confidence. So the next question is, well, exactly who is going to do events there? Who's going to finance them? And what are they going to do? And what are the things that make money? And I think while we know that there are a whole range of things that could be done there, it's a fabulous multi-purpose venue, and I'll get into that. We know that right out of the box, the thing that is going to make money for this place is concerts. And there are really three reasons for that. First, size. Size matters. The Marine Stadium is a mid-size venue. It's 6,000 seats. That is actually a very, very popular size right now. Not too big, not too large, just right. The only competition we have in Miami is the Hard Rock, not the football stadium, but the Hard Rock Casino, which seats 5,000 people. So there's a real niche in Miami for that size. The second reason is the experiential nature. More and more concerts are becoming experiential. Now, of course, after COVID, we're all excited to get out and go to a concert. But the fact is, most of us have 52-inch flat screen TVs, and we need something to get excited about. This is why concerts are getting more and more complex. So for example, you could look at Beyonce, who when she did a concert at the Marlins Stadium a few years ago, she brought in 40 tractor trailers for the stage show. You look at other trends. The Van Gogh exhibit, which is now projected on walls and ceilings, it's being done in Miami and other cities. All you architects out there, go look something called the MSG Sphere. It's being built in Las Vegas. It's a multi-sensory amphitheater. It costs $1.7 billion. The great thing about the Marine Stadium is it has all of those sensations, but it does it naturally. I've spoken to enough people who attended events there. I never did. The word that's always used is magic. Some of you may remember Tony Goldman, who developed Ocean Drive and Wynwood and Soho. Nobody could recognize potential better than Tony. I brought Tony into the Marine Stadium a few years ago. He took one look at this place and said, oh my God, this is going to be one of the great places in the world. So the stadium does all of those things, but it doesn't have to have all the technical stuff to do it. The third reason why the stadium will be very successful concerts is a concept called residency. And this was brought to me by a fellow named David Saltz, who I spent a lot of time working with. David was a producer at the highest levels. He did 5 Super Bowl halftime shows. And if anybody saw CBS Sunday Morning last week and they saw the segment on Prince and they talked about his Super Bowl halftime show, which is probably the greatest ever, well, that was David Saltz. And David acquainted me with this concept. And what it means is this. The way tours used to work is that you would go from town to town and pick the largest venue you could possibly fill, whether it's a 19,000 seat arena, and you'd play for one date. What began happening 10 years ago, and this was in Las Vegas, people like Celine Dion would go to the Venetian for a month and do a residency. In the same way, that concept that David told me about 6 years ago is really taking hold. So last year, when Madonna came to Miami, she didn't go to the Heat Arena. She went to the Fillmore in Miami Beach and did 6 shows. Diana Ross had a residency scheduled. David Byrne and Bruce Springsteen did very successful residencies on Broadway. Here's what that means for the Marine Stadium, because it's really important. You look at somebody like the Dave Matthews Band. 10 years ago, they wouldn't think twice of going to a place like the Marine Stadium. They'd go to American Airlines Arena. But the benefit for touring artists of residencies is you get to stay in one place, you get the intimate experience of a smaller crowd, and you don't have to move all of that equipment. You could realistically get the Dave Matthews Band at the Marine Stadium for 5 or 6 dates. That makes absolutely an enormous difference to this whole thing. I think stepping back, of course, there are a lot of other things you could do. Yes, boat racing, it's not the sport it was. The big boats can't race there for environmental reasons, but it's a niche, family-oriented spot. Fabulous opportunity for all kinds of physical activities. It's a world-class triathlon site. Also, sort of more unusual things, drone racing, ACT Productions, one of the finest production companies in South Florida, sees great use for water-related shows. Very popular in Las Vegas. Cirque du Soleil has a water show, O. And what's true of all of these other things, we don't know financially how they'll do. There's a learning curve on how this place is going to be used, but we're already seeing that activity. So for example, 6 years ago, ACT brought in Audemars Piguet. During Art Basel, the watch company, they spent about $750,000. They had 2 French artists do an inflatable full-size Swiss chalet, put it on a barge up at the Marine Stadium. It was fabulous. And then you look at other sort of indications of what's going on. A year and a half ago, Kanye West, he did an opera at the Hollywood Bowl. Well, when he came to Miami for Art Basel last year, he wanted to do one at the Marine Stadium, couldn't do it. It was just positioned in front of just off to the side. We were even seeing interest in sponsorships. A big global, and that's very important for feasibility. A big global brand, Heineken, has done 2 major ad campaigns for the stadium. And they did a video that went viral, generated 39 million views. They've seen the potential for this place. We get press like crazy, Sports Illustrated magazine. So I think sort of stepping back, I see the stadium as one of the truly great venues in the world, easily comparable to Hollywood Bowl, Red Rocks, except with a more varied repertoire of things to do. So
Don, sorry,
can I just give you 30 more seconds to finish up?
Okay.
All right. Sorry, I'm just about done. So my close is this, you know, all of these things are very encouraging. At the end of the day, the city has to make a bet. Now, 20 years ago, we made that bet with the Performing Arts Center. We invested $500 million and we built 2 2,600 seat theaters. And most people would suggest that worked out really well. What we're talking about here is 10 cents on the dollar, $50 million for 1 absolutely iconic 6,000 seat venue. It will be one of the 5 greatest open air venues in the world. It's why the Greater Miami Convention and Visitors Bureau and Bill Talbert are so enthusiastic. 2 words, as he says, no competition. So I think we make a strong case for economic feasibility. Thanks.
Thanks, Don. So let me, now I went to, we're already just about at 7:15, and I'm happy to I know that there's just a lot of information that we all want to get out, and we have questions, but I think it's important to talk a little bit more because of some of the questions that we've had. You were talking, Rosa, about restoration.
Yes.
What is the to those of us that are not experts in, you know, what is the process of getting, you know, taking off so much, many of those layers and layers and layers without destroying the concrete? And what's the status? I mean, is it something that, you know, that has to really, you know, that has to be painted over, or you have to just peel each layer off and let you go?
It's neither of those things. You don't paint it over because the building's not intended to be painted. You have to get back to the raw concrete. So what you have to do is take it off using methods that are neither going to damage the concrete or drive the paint into the finish. And we've done several iterations of testing on the building. And what you have to do is, there's a couple of different processes. I'm trying to be careful here not to give the methods out because they do need to be tested. There's a couple of different methods. The thicker layers, because there's, you know, there's about this much paint in places. And that layer, you have to get that off with one method, and then whatever's embedded into the surface with a second method. And the method that works the best for those top thick layers is dry ice blasting, because what happens is they come in with dry ice machines, and the paint layers actually freeze and kind of cleave off. But then you have, then the hard part starts, where you have to go in close to the surface, close to the finish, and you have to have an operator that really knows what they're doing, and they have to be watched like a hawk the whole time to make sure, because one false move and you damage the surface, but there's a way not to do that. It's a totally doable process. And the fact of the matter is, you know, there's been a lot of discussion because, you know, people have felt like, oh, well, why take the layers of paint off? This building is now known for this. A whole generation of stakeholders knows it as this. Well, in part, it has to do with the fact that the repairs can't really be safely made without that. And that probably, you know, the good thing is, you know, the interesting thing is that Hilario is extremely grateful to the graffiti community and the street art community for laying claim to the building when the city didn't want it anymore, and to really bring this new generation of people to pay attention to it. But the fact is that the repair of the building requires getting down to the concrete, making sure that it's safe, that nothing's crumbling, that the rebar could be accessed and protected properly. The real question is not, are you going to save the graffiti? Because graffiti just gets, you know, street art gets, you know, replenished all the time. An individual mural or painting lives online, and the images that Rich said would be projected on big screens. And, you know, really, I personally alone have 20,000 images of Miami Marine Stadium street art, and so do many other people. But the key issue is getting the building safe first. But the question is, why aren't you going to allow tagging again? I think that's probably because it's been a hard enough sell to get a stakeholder to come in and lay claim to operating the building. And you know, I would suppose if somebody really, you know, if that was a condition, you know, if like you got Kanye West or somebody to say, no, but I want the building tagged up again, that could be a conversation. But for the time being, presenting the blank canvas, if you will, seems the most prudent thing. That's what it seems like to me. But Rich and Don, you may know more about that.
Well, so why don't we take this time to give give the three of you an opportunity to give us your closing thoughts. Rich, could you just talk for a minute also about why you think it's important to save historic iconic structures like this?
Well, that's a great question, and that's certainly the question you're supposed to ask.
Thank you.
Preservationist, right? Yeah. And you know, we can list all of the reasons that a building such as this, and such as our other historic buildings, why we list them on the National Register, why we list them on the local register, and what that means. But at the end of the day, it is so we, because we're talking about our heritage, this building is as much of our heritage as the Freedom Tower is of our heritage, as the Olympia Theater is of our heritage, as Vizcaya and the is of our heritage, as the Biltmore Hotel is of our heritage. Yes, it's a different architectural style. And we've seen, you know, we're fortunate in Miami to have dozens of architectural styles that have architectural significance. But when we talk about saving a building and saving a building such as this, we're talking about saving our heritage for future generations, for our children and our children's children. This is who we are, who we were, who we are, and who we're going to be. And what it takes is to have the political will to understand the importance of these things, as other communities have. And as Don said, to work towards making them financially viable. And sometimes even when they're not financially viable, their importance goes well beyond the whether or not it makes a particular profit, because its importance to the community is more important than its profitability.
I agree with you wholeheartedly. Don, do you have some closing words that you want to
share? Yes, I do. I'd like to comment on where we are and where we're going. We're close. A lot of things have been done. Architectural plans are complete. There's a financing plan in place. The city authorized a revenue bond. There's additional funding from FIND and also Miami-Dade County. The city has done an economic feasibility study. They're doing a facilities feasibility study. And I have to say, in the 13 years I've been working on it, this thing has been almost demolished 6 times. So I'm happy we're still standing and we're close. And by the way, we got a huge break in November that nobody appreciates, which is when the Miami International Boat Show moved to Miami Beach. What that means for the stadium, and I supported the boat show, is that frees up the 110 days a year that they were on that site during peak season to set up and take down the show. So here's really where we stand right now. We're going to be going back to Miami City Commission at some point in the next few months. And I'm not sure what's going to trigger that. It might be a request to put the whole project out to bid, because Rich and Rosa, I think, are pretty much ready for that. It might be a request to do an RFP for an operator. It might be brought up by a city commissioner as a discussion items. If this had happened 4 years ago, I would say we'd get approval on a 4-to-1 basis because of all of the advocacy we've done. Now, we've got several new commissioners, and we are going to need to do some advocacy and what would make, and make a stand. What we've done previously is working with the National Trust, and a shout out to Paul Edmondson, the president, and Jason Clement, the director of marketing, who might be on the line. They've been fabulous for us for 12 years, is they've helped to put together a link where people can click on it, write 2 sentences, click it again. It goes to City Commission, and I'll tell you that has made a huge difference. I remember we used to sit down with Francis in 2011 when he was a commissioner, and he'd say, I'm on the fence about this project. We swamped him with 1,300 emails. That made a difference. So there's going to come a time where Cheryl and Rosa and Rich and Chris and I and the trust, we're going to ask you to, here's the link, fill it out, send it to your friends. And I'd say if you know of organizations or press who are interested. And I'd just like to say one more thing that we're planning. This building is just so amazing. It's wonderful heritage for the Cuban community of Miami, which Rosa knows really well. And the fact that Hilario, the guy who designed it 60 years ago, is alive is ridiculous. So we're working on a presentation to include Rosa, Hilario, some folks from the World Monuments Fund who put it on their watch list in English and Spanish, and reach out to the Cuban community so they can understand the amazing treasure that they have in their midst. This building is recognized nationally and internationally. Time for the local community that created it to take pride in it. So we'll be in touch with you. I am more optimistic than ever. We can do it, but we're really going to need everybody's help.
Absolutely. I applaud that. We will need everyone's help, and we will do our best here at MCAD to work with everyone to get it out there, and we really have to do whatever it takes to save and restore
when it's
treasure.
Gone, yeah.
When it's gone, it's gone.
It's gone. Absolutely. It's gone. Right. And it's the most significant building by a Cuban American in the United States.
Recognized by the
National Trust. That doesn't mean anything to Miami. I don't know. Yeah. I'm not sure what that would mean.
Rosa, it's the trifecta: National Trust, World Monuments Fund, and thanks to you, the Getty Foundation.
So we're excited to see this move forward. Stay tuned because we may have other programming on this. And Chris, I think you're still on. I know that the trust will, Dade Heritage Trust will be working very hard and we'll be working with them on this. So thank you, everyone. Thanks, Richard. Your presentation was amazing. The designs are gorgeous. And Rosa, thanks for your expertise. Don, thanks for your energy and keeping this alive. And thanks to everyone who logged on today.
I should just say we welcome everybody's contacts, ideas, other organizations to approach, press, anybody you can think of, I'll follow up with.
Absolutely. And also, if we will, this has been recorded and we will be, this will be on the MCAD website and I think also on the DHT website or their YouTube channel. So again, thank you everyone. And we'll look forward to the next chat about it. Get ready, guys, get ready.
I'll be sending out a survey to all of you, a short survey that you should be getting an email. And if you could take a moment and fill it out, it will help us a lot with our programming. So thank you everyone for coming. And we really appreciate it. And thank you to our panelists.
And we thank you all for your support. Have a great evening, everyone.
Good night.
Thanks, everybody.
Awesome. Are we staying on?